everyone, I'm Norman Welber and welcome to the Algebraic Calculus. So in this lecture we're going to be looking at the geometrical underpinnings of the subject, which is basically sort of linear algebra or affine geometry, and also the corresponding algebraic setup that captures those geometrical notions. Logically, it's usually the algebraic setup which is primary for us, but we like to have pictures in mind as well. And notably, the pictures are not those of Euclidean geometry. So the usual pictures that you find in most calculus textbooks are not exactly in the direction we're thinking. We're adopting rather a more affine geometry point of view, and I want to explain that because it might not be that familiar to you. So roughly what we're doing is we're thinking about geometry in the plane with the notion of parallelism first and foremost in our minds, so that perpendicularity is not actually going to play a role. Okay, so here is a picture of an XY plane, maybe a little bit different from what you're used to because these axes don't appear exactly perpendicular to you. And you can see that the spacing in the X directions and the spacings in the Y directions are not exactly the same. Although along the X direction we have equal spacing and along the Y direction we have equal spacing, but this separation here and this separation here are not really corresponding. Okay, so that's the basic setup. We might call that the affine plane. And a natural question is, you know, how do you organize such a thing? And, you know, it turns out there's a Renaissance artist kind of point of view that allows one to create such a thing if you just have a draftsman's tool that allows you to create parallel lines. So suppose we have such a kind of affine grid, then we can talk about points and lines, which are at least the first fundamental objects of study. So a point for us will be something like this, A equals 3, 2, that represents the point, which is 3 in the x direction, 2 in the y direction. There it is there. So what we do is we go to the x position here that's labeled by 3, and then we draw a line through that which is parallel to the y-axis. And we simultaneously go up to the position on the y-axis corresponding to 2 and draw through that a line parallel to the x-axis. Okay, and then it's the meat of these two lines that determines that point, A. And the other kind of ingredient that we'll need is that of a line, okay? And a line for us is an equation like this, x plus 2y equals 2. This equation describes this line. Maybe the name of this line is L, okay? It passes through the point 0, 1. It also passes through the point 2, 0, and of course, through many other points. So we want to become sort of familiar first with this basic setup where we do not assume perpendicular kind of standard Euclidean graph paper kind of framework. Okay, this is somewhat more general. All right, so now let's make an official definition, basically an algebraic definition. We'll say that an affine point is a pair of numbers in square brackets. For example, this thing here. There's square brackets, and there's two numbers, 1 and 5 over 2, and they're separated by a comma. There's a left bracket on this side and a right bracket on this side, and these are square brackets. Okay, so this is an affine point, and in this case, its name is capital A. So we say A equals the point 1, 5 over 2. Now, in this course, when we refer to numbers, the default is usually rational numbers because this is a very algebraic approach. So for us, real numbers are highly problematic, and we're going to avoid them almost entirely, surprisingly. But we are going to allow the possibility of extending our considerations to other fields also. In particular, later on, to finite fields. So ultimately, the same kinds of definitions will also work if we replace our notion of number with the notion of a finite field number, whatever that is. You don't need to understand what that is at this stage. Okay, but currently the default when I say number is it's a rational number, like a fraction. Now, this point is a purely expression-oriented object, but it can be interpreted geometrically in a wide variety of ways. So here is one possible interpretation. Here is one kind of representation of an affine plane, and then the point here, A, is 1, 5 over 2. Here's another representation, a different kind of affine plane. 1 and 5, 2, there's the point A in this scenario. So both of these are correct and illustrate this idea that it's not really the geometry that's primary, it's the algebra that's primary, and a given algebraic object will have many different geometrical manifestations or interpretations. Okay, so that's our rough orientation to things. Okay, we're going to start with the algebraic thing. We're going to say precisely what we mean when we write something down, typically as an expression involving certain symbols, and then we're going to interpret that in perhaps a different number of ways, geometrically. All right, and our second definition is that of an affine line. Okay, so a line for us is an equation in the variables x and y of the following form, ax plus by equals c, where a, b, and c are numbers, with the crucial condition that a and b, these two numbers here, are not both zero. One of them can be zero, but not both of them. That's what a line will be for us. So for us, a line is not a set of points. It is not a set of points. If it were a set of points, then we would have to worry about, you know, how to encode this set of points onto our hard drive, which is basically an impossibility. Unless you're working over a finite field, then you can do it. But over the rationals, you can't describe all the points on this, and that doesn't even have any meaning to me because there's all these difficulties associated with dealing with numbers which are so big that they don't fit into the universe. Okay, so I don't want to go there. So it's much better if we just think about a line not as a set of points but actually as just an equation. Now, however, we do have to say that there's some ambiguity here because a given equation can be expressed in alternate ways. So we could perform algebraic manipulations. For example, the line x plus 3y equals 2. Okay? We could multiply that equation by 2 to get the line 2x plus 6y equals 4, and we would want these two to be the same line. Or maybe we could bring the 2 to the other side here, get minus 2 plus x plus 3y equals 0. Or maybe we could solve for y, bring the x to the other side and divide by 3 to get y equals minus 1/3 x plus 2/3. So these are all the same line for us. Now maybe that's a little bit unsatisfactory, and I hope you do feel that a little bit, okay? That it's a little bit ambiguous because now how is our computer going to tell whether this line is equal to this line? And that in fact will motivate in a short while talking about an alternate form of describing lines involving projective ideas, okay? So we're going to get to that. But at least at this stage here, this connects with standard high school terminology. So we now have points and we have lines as linear equations in x and y. So we know what a point is, we know what a line is. Now we have to describe the relationship between them. We say that a point A, which is say x0, y0, lies on the line L, given by the equation ax plus by equals c, precisely when ax0 plus by0 equals c. In other words, the equation is satisfied if you plug in the values of x0, y0 that define a into x and y. There's alternate notation or terminology for this. We equivalently say that the line L passes through a, or sometimes we say that the point A is incident with the line L. Great. Okay, another important definition is this basic idea of parallelism, which I said was at the heart of affine geometry. So we should say when two lines are parallel. So the line L1, say, with equation A1x plus B1y equals C1, and the line L2, which is A2x plus B2y equals C2, they are parallel precisely when the following relation is satisfied. When A1 times B2 minus A2 times B1 equals 0. Now in this situation, we will sometimes write that L1 is parallel to L2 by using two vertical bars to represent parallelism. This is a very important kind of expression that we're going to be seeing quite a lot in this course, all right? So this is our first example of it. It's describing parallelism of two lines. And I've arranged the indices here, so instead of having A, B, and C, and D, E, and F, it's maybe a little bit easier to remember this if we go to the additional work of using indices. So ones for this first line and twos for the second line. It somehow makes things consistent and reduces the number of variables altogether, even at the cost of a slight amount of extra work with the indices. So that's something that we're gonna have to play off against each other quite a lot in the course, you know. So anyway, I just point that out, that sometimes it's nice to use indices to sort of organize or bookkeep the objects that we're interested in. Okay, so there is the definition of parallelism for lines. A few more hopefully familiar definitions. We'll say that points A, B, and C are collinear precisely when they all lie on a given line L. And we'll say that lines K, L, and M, say, are concurrent precisely when they all pass through a given point A. So for example, here's a picture of three collinear points. They all happen to lie on this line. So the point A, point B, point C. The point A here is the y-intercept of this line. It's the point 0, 2. The point B here is the x-intercept of this line. It's the point 3, 0. And here's another point on it, say C, which has x-coordinate 1. And then to find the y-coordinate, we would sort of plug x equals 1 here and solve for y and get 4 over 3. Here is an example of a point with three lines through it. So these are three concurrent lines. The point is 2, 1. And the lines are, well, here's the line x equals 2. Okay, that's a valid line. Here's the line y equals 1, which is a valid line. And here's some other line. It happens to be x plus y equals 3. And we can check that that actually does pass through A because 2 plus 1 does equal 3. Okay, so we have collinear points and concurrent lines. Now we want to augment our number system a little bit. Think about numbers in not just an absolute way, but in a kind of a relative way. So for example, if I have two objects and I want to sort of compare them, let's say I want to compare their weights, one way is to sort of weigh this one and get a number, and the other one, then weigh this one and get a number, and then compare those two numbers. But another way is to not worry about the actual absolute measurements of those weights of the two things, but just the relative weights. So maybe we can establish that this one weighs twice as much as this one without actually individually weighing them both. So we get a proportion. The weights are in the proportion 2 to 1. So this kind of relative notion of numbers was very important to the Greeks, who thought geometrically, okay, rather than arithmetically primarily. But so they had maybe one segment like this, and maybe another segment, you know, half the size, and they would say, well, the proportion this segment to this segment is 2 to 1, that kind of thing. So we want to allow ourselves some flexibility in terms of being able to use this kind of notion of number sometimes, okay? So we're gonna introduce the idea of proportion here, okay? So what is a proportion? Well, there are different kinds of proportions. The simplest ones are the two proportion. So a two proportion is an expression A to B, where there's a colon here, okay? So A colon B, where A and B are numbers. In other words, typically rational numbers. Not both zero. One of them could be zero. A could be zero, but then B cannot be zero. Or B could be zero, in which case A could not be zero. With the following convention, that we agree that a certain proportion is equal to another proportion in a certain situation. We say that A to B equals C to D precisely when AD minus BC equals zero. Hopefully that looks a little bit familiar. Okay, so this is the fundamental notion of equality between proportions. A three proportion is something similar, but we are comparing three things, not two things. So it's an expression A1 to A2 to A3, where now A1, A2, and A3 are numbers not all zero, with the corresponding convention that one 3 proportion, say A1, A2, A3, equals a second 3 proportion, B1, B2 to B3, precisely when A1, B2 minus A2, B1 equals 0, and A2, B3 minus A3, B2 equals 0, and A1, B3 minus A3, B1 equals 0. So the same kinds of relations occurring in a 2 proportion are occurring here, but 3 different ways, corresponding to pairing the 1s and the 2s, the 2s and the 3s, and the 1s and the 3s. Now, proportions are kind of close to my heart because I wrote a book called Divine Proportions. Okay, this is my book on rational trigonometry, which I hope you've all heard of, and I hope that maybe some of you have read, or if you haven't, that you will read it at some point, because then you'll learn the very important new geometrical understanding of rational trigonometry. And the notion of proportion encoded here plays a kind of a central role in setting up this entire new theory of trigonometry. Okay. So it's a quite a useful thing, even though it goes back to antiquity. We'll see that it's very useful for us. So the proportions satisfy some nice little propositions. The first one captures the idea of an equivalence relation, okay, that proportions really provide us with an example of an equivalence relation. That amounts to three sort of simple properties that proportions satisfy. The first one is very simple, that A to B equals A to B. Now you may think, well, why do we have to check that? How's that a proposition? Isn't that obvious? Well, kind of, but maybe not entirely, because remember, we defined equality in a very precise way. We said that this proportion is equal to this proportion when AD minus BC equals zero. So there's something to check before we can state that two proportions are equal. In this case, you have to check that this number times this number minus this number times this number is equal to zero. Okay, and obviously it is, but that's still something that you have to check. If you had some more convoluted notion of equality, then maybe this property wouldn't actually be satisfied. Then you might wonder why you're actually considering that. So, you know, but anyway, that's an important property. Here's another kind of obvious property, that A to B equals C to D is really the same as C to D equals A to B. So in other words, if these two proportions are equal, then these two proportions are also equal. And the last one, transitivity, that if A to B equals C to D and C to D equals E to F, then we can conclude that A to B equals E to F. You might like to prove this for yourself. Okay, the corresponding facts also hold for three proportions, so there's a corresponding set of statements for three proportions. And here's another sort of useful way of thinking about this equality of proportions, that A to B equals C to D precisely when C is lambda A and D is lambda B for some non-zero number lambda. So in other words, this proportion's obtained from this one by scaling up both of the numbers by the same non-zero amount. Because it's another way of thinking about what equality of proportions means, that it's invariant under non-zero scaling. So that's great. So we've learned a little bit about basic affine geometry and proportions.